might be your first opportunity to worship here. We believe that this table is the Lord's table and is open to all. All are welcome at our Lord's meal. Everything you need for worship is printed right in front of you, so please follow right along. However, the hymns that are posted come out of that cranberry color book. This is the first Sunday in... Very good. Not Christmas. Not in this room, at least. It's sort of getting there, and we'll talk about it, but this is the first Sunday of Advent as we begin the process of preparing for our Lord to come. With that said, I will turn it over to Amanda.
Good morning. Since it is the first Sunday in Advent, we have a couple of Advent things happening. One is if you have children who normally get the bulletin, the children's bulletin, we have a change in that. We now have two bulletins. One is for a reader and one is for pre-readers. And they coordinate with the Spark Bible that's in the pew in front of you. So hopefully you picked up a new children's bulletin this morning. And I'd like some feedback on those. So if you normally get the Spark children's bulletin, if you will, if you'll just let me know how you like it compared to the old ones. Also, for families, we have Advent devotionals. They're out in the narthex on the bookcase. It's Jesus, God's Promise. So pick one of those up. It's a daily devotional that you can do with your family or on your own. And also, we would like to make sure that our local community is invited to all of our Christmas happenings, especially Christmas Eve service. So on the bookshelf in the narthex, you'll also find some flyers and some cards. And these cards have our weekly worship time and our candlelight Christmas Eve worship time and directions and a phone number to call. So please pick these up. And if you are out in the community this week and the next couple weeks, take a stack, leave it at your favorite restaurant, give it to your friend, pass it along to colleagues. This is just another way that we're trying to do some intentional invitation and get folks, let folks know that there's a place here to be welcome during the Christmas season. So these are out in the narthex as well. In your bulletin today, there are several different things going on. First and foremost, after worship today, we're going to be decorating for Advent here in the sanctuary. So the hanging of the greens will be today. So right after worship, please plan to stay for a few minutes and help us with decorating the Christmas tree, hanging the greens, and getting the area ready for the Advent season. Play practice will also be right after church. That's going to be down in the youth room. It should be 20 or 30 minutes. We're just going to assign parts and take some time to talk about what the play looks like and how we're going to do that. So plan to stay with us for that as well. This week on Tuesday night, Beer and Bible is going to be meeting at Sophie's Cork and Ale at 7 o'clock. There is nursery provided, so join us for that. Next Saturday... plan to join the bakers at their annual Christmas party for lots of fun. And Patsy, you going to tell us more about that?
Yes.
Okay, so Saturday at 6, everyone is invited to the bakers. Their address is in the directory if you don't have that. Your ticket to get in is to bring a canned food. They donate those to the Southmont Food Pantry. Thank you. Still, I was searching for that word. And bring a light finger food to share. Okay? And then plan on Sunday night, we will have our annual Christmas banquet and play. So that will be next Sunday night for that. Offering envelopes are in the narthex, and beside of the offering envelopes, you'll see shut-in gifts. If you are visiting one of our shut-ins or you would like to visit one of our shut-ins, please take a gift. These were made by the Sunday school children, and just write who you got the gift for and your name. There's a list of the people that they're for, and you write your name beside who you're taking the gift to, so we make sure that all of our shut-ins get their little Christmas goodie from our Sunday school participants. There are two extras, so if you know somebody who's not on the list but would appreciate or enjoy something from our Sunday school kiddos, they're out there. Oh, and lastly, our angels, well, two things. If you made cookies for our college students, you can leave those either in the youth room or in the kitchen. I'm hoping to send out those college cookies tomorrow. So drop them off sometime today or tomorrow morning, please. And then Angel Tree. So excited that all of our angels got taken. If you took an angel, please make sure to have your gifts wrapped and back in the chapel area, toward the back of the chapel, by December 16th. That next week is when they'll be handed out at Southwood. So thank you so much to everybody who participated in that. Yes, ma'am. I can, and can I elaborate to you in person?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, I'll see you after worship. Thank you.
We've had several members who've had procedures, and all the procedures went real well. I'm not sure if they want me to make a big deal of it, but just give thanks that we have hospitals and doctors and good results. However, I just got this morning that we need prayers for a family of a 10-month-old. Her name is Tegan Kohler. I think I said that right. And she was born with a genetic disorder, and she died. She died yesterday in Pennsylvania. She was the niece of the workman's sister-in-law. They told a story of taking her to see Santa and doing things before her death. So they celebrated with her, but we pray for that family. What a hard time to grieve, so we hold them in our prayers. I also got word that Jeff Hoffman's father is back in the, so we keep him in prayer and hope that's okay. He was planning on coming this way. I got all this from Mary Lou. and that we hold him in prayer. So are there any other joys or concerns? Yes. Oh yes, prayer shawls, absolutely.
We have three shawls today. This one is for Shelby Von Cannon. I think she's having a much harder time now, and so she just needs some encouragement from us. Alice Galco, I believe hospice has been called in for her. And then this one is for my Aunt Sib, Sib Snyder. She failed this week and fractured her pelvic bone, and she's still in the hospital, but they're going to be releasing her to rehab. Thank you.
Are there any joys or concerns? Anything else? If not, then let's take this time with our prelude as we prepare our hearts to come into our Lord's presence. Thank you. Please stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the Lord of Israel, who comes to set us free, the mighty Savior who comes to show mercy, the dawn from on high who guides us into peace. Amen. Let us come before God in confession. To you, O God, we lift our souls. You know us through and through. We confess our sins to you. Remember not our sins. Remember us with your steadfast love. Show us your ways. Teach us your path and lead us into justice and truth. For the sake of the goodness in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Children of God, come with joy and draw water from the well of salvation. Remember the gift of baptism. Your sin is washed away. In the name of Jesus, you belong to Christ. You are anointed to serve. Stand up, raise your heads. The reign of God is near. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
For the peace in the world, for the health of the church, for the unity of all. For this holy house, for all who worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. That we may live out your impassioned response to the hungry and the poor. That we may live out truth and justice and grace, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. For peace in our hearts, for peace in our homes, for friends and family. For life and for love, for our work and our play, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. For your Spirit to guide, that you center our lives in the water and the Word. That you nourish our souls with your body and blood, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Let us pray. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. By your merciful protection, alert us to the threatening dangers of our sins and to redeem us for life of justice. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
There. Savior, today we light the first candle of Advent. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe. You call all nations to walk in your light and to seek your ways of justice and peace. Bless us as we light the first candle of this wreath. Rouse us from sleep that we may be ready to greet our Lord when he comes and welcome him into our hearts and homes. For he is our light and our salvation. Blessed be God forever. Amen.
Come forward at this time. We're going to sit right here. Yeah, you do it. But yeah, you're going to hand them out, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody have. I want everybody to see up front.
Sit down here.
Sit down here. Can you have a seat? Oh, good for you. Have a seat. Have a seat right there. I want y'all to be able to look up this way. Sit down.
Sit down here on this part. Oh, because you're going to be able to look this way.
He's good. Okay, I want y'all to look up. Is everybody here? I want you to see what, tell me what you see. Just tell me what you see. What do you see? See a cross. What looks different? Yeah. What is that?
Angel.
It's an angel, but does it look finished? Doesn't look finished. What else? What else do you see?
I see a branch.
You see a what? Do you say a tree? Do you see a tree? Look at the tree. You see a tree in here? Is that tree always there?
No.
But what about the tree? When you look at the tree, what do you think?
It's Christmas.
Is it though?
It's almost got
birthday. Yeah, but it almost is. But is it finished?
No.
Well, look at this wreath. Is the wreath?
No.
How many? Come back, guys. Come on. So let me ask you, if out in the world they're talking about Christmas, guess what we're talking about in this church? Yes. It's called Advent. And guess what we do for Advent?
Did you know at Christmas we celebrate Jesus?
That's right, but we don't celebrate it. Guess what we're doing right now? We are waiting. Guess what we're waiting for? We're waiting for Christmas, right? How does it feel to wait?
Bad.
Nobody likes to wait. Nobody likes to wait. As a matter of fact, this is a season that's probably like most of our lives where, you know what, we remember Jesus came, but guess what else we're doing? We're waiting for Jesus to come back. So we see signs. Do you see signs of Jesus coming? But is it, you know what's going to happen in this room over the next 4 weeks? We're going to add a little more and add a little more and add a little more, right? And then we'll light a couple more candles, right? So we have a way of marking time. So, Amanda?
And it's my favorite way of marking time. Have you ever seen an Advent calendar like this?
Yes.
Okay, today is really the first day of Advent, but it's the second day of December.
What? Wait.
And it's got a Bible verse, and what else does it have? So these are your Advent calendars. How many doors do you open every day?
One.
Wait, don't go yet.
To help you for the waiting. Today's a special day because it's the first day of Advent, so you get to open two doors. One and two.
But only two today.
One.
Hey, here's another idea, and you could ask your mom and dad to put four candles in your house, and every Sunday you light a candle, too. Yeah, once chocolate, you're done. Let us pray. Before you go, let us pray. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this season. Dear Lord, let us see signs and little taste of chocolate as we prepare for that day when you will come and there will be a great feast. We pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you very much.
A reading from Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Thank you, John. How's this? A reading from Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. Psalm 25 will be read responsively. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. Do not let those who wait for you be put to shame. Let them be ashamed, and who are wantonly treacherous. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for your goodness' sake, O Lord. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy that we feel before our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you face to face and restore whatever is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, just as we abound in love for you. And may he so strengthen your hearts in holiness that you may be blameless before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and the earth distress amongst nations, confused by the roaring of seas and waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding, and what is coming upon the earth. For the powers of heaven will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up, raise your heads, because the redemption is drawing near." Then he told them a parable. "Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourself and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dispensation and drunkenness and worries of this life, and that the day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all things that will take place and to stand before the Son of God." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. We are in, this is like church New Year's Sunday. You know, this is the beginning of a new year in our calendar. This Sunday starts that. And so now we transition from the Gospel of Mark to the Gospel of Luke. And one of the kind of the each gospel has its own characteristics. And one is that if Matthew and Mark are more kind of have a Jewish flavor, Luke has a little bit more of a Roman flavor. You have Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. There's kind of reoccurring themes that I'll talk over and over again. One is redemption. Christ who redeems. The other one is the kingdom. The kingdom that is near and the kingdom that is coming. There is a volume 2 to Luke that I don't think people remember sometimes. The second volume of Luke, and we know it was the same writer, it's called the Book of Acts. So you almost should think of Luke and Acts as one big long story. And in that story, what we hear a whole lot about, is the ascension of Jesus and the Holy Spirit in the world. So God is kind of like this. God is in the world, but God is not quite in the world, right? And it even says in the text this morning, heaven and earth will pass away. It's almost like there is a day when this will become this, right? There'll no longer be a heaven, and there'll no longer be an earth. They will just be the kingdom. Right, the two will pass away and become one. But as for now, right, as for now. And this is where I'm going to tell you what you don't want to hear. Advent is the season that we live all year long. Right? We love all the other ones. Oh, we love Christmas. But we're living in that time. Right, that kind of great in-between time between Christ who has come and Christ who will come again. Right, we live in that parallel reality. And we've been doing that for 2,000 years now. Right, we've been living with God who is with us, but also God who is coming. Believe it or not, this is the favorite year of most pastors. And it's the one that our parishioners hate the most. Go figure, right? Because it's what we are. We are a waiting people. Right? That's why you don't like the hymns, Advent hymns. And that's why you want everything to look like Christmas. But it's just not, we're not there yet. We see signs of it, right? You see, well, there's the tree. The Christmons aren't quite there. There's the manger, but there's no shepherds or... The room builds. That's the whole idea. That's why we don't light all four. We just light one and then two and then... But in the meantime, right? In the meantime, that's what all these texts are, is who will we be in the meantime? And the thing I love about this text is we think of Christ's return as this time of great fear. I can remember as a kid, I watched this movie. It was one of those late 70s, you know, rapture movies that they were really cheaply made, and they scared literally the hell out of me, right? They were scary movies. Jesus coming back, when somebody said Jesus is returning, it scared me. I've told you this scene before. I tell it every Advent. So the wife is talking to her husband, and the husband is shaving with an electric shaver. And they're talking, and then you hear the shaver fall in the sink, and it's rattling around, and the wife's going, "Honey, honey, honey." And you walk in, and there's he's been raptured while he's shaving, right? Just the notion of that scared me, right? Because that's what I was sort of told. That's the way God is, right? The good people get to go be with God, and the bad people have to stay on earth, and, you know, bad things happen. But is that what we hear in this text? Is that what Jesus is saying? It's going to happen. I'm coming back. And what do you do when there's all these bad things happen? You stand up. You raise your head. Your redemption is near. Christ is coming. That is good news for a broken, sinful world. Here's the other thing. These Christians living in this in-between place, life's not good, right? The temple has been destroyed. Rome has turned on this new sect of, they don't know if they're Jewish, and they talk about eating flesh and drinking blood. These, we don't know what to call them. They're followers of Christ. We'll call them Christians. They're being persecuted. There are wars and rumors of wars. What's going on in Rome right now? But if the barbarians are at the gates, the world is out of control for these early Christians. Does this feel any different? Do you see? And that's what the gospel writer is speaking to, that fear, that desperation. And what is he saying? Yes, bad things happen, but lift up your head. It will not be like this forever. Your redemption is near. Look, even in nature, you can see the little bud. Spring is close. Easter is soon to come. Lift up your heads. Rejoice. The kingdom is at hand. You know, this is not scary at all. This is comfort in the midst of what is scary. This is hope in the midst of what seems so hopeless. On a cosmic scale, and even on a personal scale, because as a pastor who does this over and over and over and over, I don't know about the future apocalypse. I don't know about the future, but as your pastor, I sit with you in your own little personal apocalypses. I sit with you in your own little pains. I listen to you when you say, "How can I go on?" That's what pastors do. And our job is not to make you feel good. Our job is to say, "Look at the little bud. Look at that little bud right there. There is still hope. Raise up your head. I know you're sad. I know it feels like the end, but raise up your head. Your redemption is close. This is not forever." So, the life expectancy in the United States for someone who's born in 2018 has gone down by 1 month. So if you're born in 2018, you will live 1 month shorter than if you were born in 2017. Now, of course, that's an average, right? But something has happened in our country. Life expectancy rates that were going up and up and up and up have plateaued, and now it's just a month. Oh, what's a month? But the thing is they've dropped. They've dropped. Do you know why they've dropped? They've pinpointed two things. The first is the opioid crisis. And the second one is suicide. We have an epidemic of opioids and suicides. And you know what some of the doctors are calling them? The illness is an illness of despair. We live in a culture, particularly younger Americans, who are have the illness of despair. Both of those things, So it goes on and it goes on and goes on, right? We live in a culture, we were just driving here today, and the Presbyterians in Moxville have something that I've seen. It's called a blue Christmas, right? I'll have a blue, literally the Elvis Presley song. I'll have a blue Christmas without you. But isn't that true? I mean, there are people in this very room who this will be the first. This will be the first Christmas without fill in the blank. And then you turn on and you watch the Lifetime and the Hallmark movies. I'm sort of picking on Tracy a little bit. And what is this season supposed to be? You know, you're supposed, oh, it's Christmas. It's magic. You know, you should just magically feel happy. Right? Advent is the time. What color is everything? It's blue. But it's not despair. Blue is the ancient symbol of hope. It is hope. And if you don't think that the church doesn't have a powerful message, we can go to the brokenhearted and go to those in despair, and we don't have the magic cure to make them feel better. I'm not saying that. But the good news is we can say, raise up your head. Your redemption is near. And remember, in Christian world, when we say things like peace, love, hope, redemption, those are not abstracts. Who is our redemption? Who is our hope? Who is our love? Who is our peace? Christ. Christ who will come as a baby and come as a young person and come as a man. Christ who will die to our brokenness and die to our despair and die to our systems of doing things. And 3 days later will rise and defeat that. And out of that resurrection comes our redemption, and out of that redemption comes our hope. We can stand in the midst of an opioid epidemic. We can stand with people who feel like, why should I keep living? And what do we have? Not a perfect answer, but the ability to point to the perfect answer and say, there is hope. There is redemption. Because spring is close. Look at the little buds, you know. How often have I sat with people in my office and heard them say, I don't know how I will ever go on. And all I can do is just say, well, look at this, and look at this, Look at this. What do we do in this very room? It's my party line. I do it every sermon. What are the little sprouts of hope in this room? Water, bread and wine, word, gathered community. I mean, are we not those sprouts of hope to people who need it so badly? Just there it is, and there it is, and there it is. The call of evangelism in this world is not for you to have all the answers to lead, to win people for Jesus. Jesus will do that on his own. Your job is to point. Say, look at there. Look at there, and look at there, and look at there. Look at the signs of hope all around you. Raise up your head. Your redemption is near. So, most of all, you know this, but some of you might not know this. How I got to First Lutheran. I got to First Lutheran because I had to resign my call at Holy Trinity in Troutman. In 09, the church made a big decision of how we are to allow people who are in lifelong same-sex relationships to be within the life of the church. And the church I was serving wanted and did leave the denomination. And I told them, I can't do that. Right? I can't do that. This is what I believe in, and this is where I stand. And it became clear, I had just bought a house. In 08, the market dumped. I literally bought a house 6 months after, right? And all I could do was draw about a 40-mile radius around my house. And in the midst of that, it became clear and clear I had to resign my, and I did, I resigned my call. And I had this night where I stayed up all night and I came to this crushing reality. I can't do anything else but this. I remember calling the bishop and saying, what am I going to do? And he said, the most comforting words were, you're going to have to figure out a way to generate some income. Right? And I thought, wow. People would say, well, you could go back into graphic design. No, I can't. When I did it, we actually drew things and used rulers and, right? There's no way. What am I going to do? And I had little kids. I mean, not little, middle school, high school age kids. But what was I going to do? And I remember sitting there thinking, how much worse can this get? And I can remember thinking, maybe I'll just compromise. And I remember going to my wife and saying, what are we going to do? And I remember she just said, it's almost like, oh, it'll be fine. Oh, it'll be fine. Just resign your call, it'll be fine. And I remember seeing how, oh, it'll be fine, even though in my head I said, no, it's not going to be fine. That was just that little spring of hope that made me go, Matt, you're doing the right thing. Raise up your head. Just raise up your head. I didn't think there would be any future past that. I thought, I don't know what I thought. I mean, that's the reality wherever you are right now, in the good or in the bad, right? In the, you know, where, in here's the ultimate reality. Even as we face death itself, our redemption is near. And there is hope in Christ even after death itself. This is the season of the church. It's all year round. The Advent season is that work of the church to stand in that place, to stand in the world of despair, to stand in the world that is afraid by things that rattle and shake around us, and to point to those little sprouts of hope all around us. Yeah, I'm pointing at you guys. Right? Amen. Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe.
As we await the coming of Christ, we pray in the hope for the church, the world, and all of creation. Equip your church, merciful God, secure our roots in the soil of your eternal word. Ease our worries and remove our shame. Grow our faithfulness and let your steadfast love blossom among us. Lord, in your mercy, sustain your creation, holy God. Water the parched soil. Restore depleted fields. Send farmers, forest rangers, and gardeners to care for fig trees and wheat fields, gardens, and arboretums. Increase our love for the land. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grow peace within us, abundant God. Raise up leaders in every community grounded in your justice and mercy. Increase their love for all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Increase our joy, wondrous God. Plant thanksgiving in our hearts and multiply the good fruit of your outreach ministries and creation care programs especially. Guide in our service to local and global neighbors. Lord, in your mercy. Feed the hungry, living God. Gather our harvest into feast for our neighbors. Move us to nurture those who are bereaved and lonely. Empower those living with HIV/AIDS and all who are sick. We especially pray for Shelby Von Cannon, Ronnie Moretz, and Jenny Beam. Be with those on our prayer list and those who we now name aloud or silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving, we remember Geraldine Hoffman and all who have died and now rest in your glory. Hold all who mourn in the comfort of your eternal light and bring us to light in the new life you promise. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
confident that the Holy Spirit intercedes for us, we bring to you these prayers and those unspoken. In the name of Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
Let us pray.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful Father, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, to whom you will also make all things new in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that by this Holy Communion we may know the unity we share with all your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him, with him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Remember us in your kingdom, O God, and teach us to pray. God fills the hungry with good things. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Thanks be to God. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gift of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen.
Holy One, we give you thanks that as in this bread and cup we have feasted again on your endless love. Let that love overflow more and more of our lives, that we may be messengers to prepare your way, harvesters of justice and righteousness, and bearers of your eternal word, our Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Gracious God, you took the form of a servant, offering yourself as food, comfort, and strength to a sick and hurting world. Anoint with a servant heart those who take your word and sacrament to our sisters and brothers who are unable to be with us today. Grant grace, mercy, healing, and hope to those who feast on your body and blood and receive your words of new life. May we all recognize that we have a place and a home in the body of our Lord Jesus Christ.
May God direct your ways in peace, make you abound in love for one another and for all, and strengthen our hearts until the coming of our Lord Jesus. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.